Thank you, Jogibet. Let me share the slide first. Thank you for this opportunity, and this is the start of a series of 6 sessions on leadership, 2 today and 4 the next 2 days. Dr. Vinod Shah will do the rest of this. So today's 2 sessions are basically looking at basics of leadership. So I've tried to lay foundations on leadership, which most of us might know, but to remind us, and then to lay a foundation so that from there you can build up over the next few days as Dr. Vinod and others start talking about rest of the deeper aspects of leadership. So over today, in today's session, we would look at some foundational understandings, look at the being of a leader, you know, what, how a leader can be, what he should be, and then what he should do, some aspects of leadership tasks. So let me start with some foundational basics. All of us know the story of Naaman. If you read through the story of Naaman, the story is that Naaman was the commander, and then he had leprosy. And as he was suffering with leprosy, his servant lady girl, who was from Israel, came to know about this and brought this information to Naaman's wife that there is a prophet in Samaria that he can cure him of leprosy. Hearing that, Naaman goes to the king of Aram, and the king of Aram decides to send a letter to king of Israel. But when he reaches king of Israel, his king of Israel gets really upset. He thinks that, you know, there's a ploy to put them, off the Aram king to do something with them. But Elisha comes to hear about how king of Israel has torn his ropes, and then sends the information saying that, you know, why have you torn your ropes? There is a prophet here. I am here. I'll take care of it. And then the story goes on where Elisha tells Naaman to go and wash, and then the story, there are various aspects of the story. I want to ask this question: who are all the leaders here? Who are all the leaders in this story? If you want to put your thoughts in your chat, you can put your thoughts. Otherwise, at the end, we can have a discussion on this. The question to ask is, who is a leader? And if you look at the story, there are 4 positional leaders. There is the king of Aram, the king of Israel, the king of Samaria, prophet who had a position, and Naaman. All of them had positions. There was the wife of Naaman, who was a housewife, a homemaker, also a position, important position. And the servant who had the least position in that group. But if you look at, each of them had a role. But the most crucial person around which the whole story revolves is the young servant girl. That girl, when she brought that information to the group, that became the start of the whole process of healing. So we want to look at leadership from that perspective. A leader is a person who can influence. So for our understanding for the next 3 days, this is a foundation. Leadership is an influence. Anybody who can influence his or her area of influence, the place where God has kept them, whether you have a position or not, whether you have a formal position or not, but a person who can influence the context in which God has kept is a leader. And if so, a leadership is about influence. So this is the foundation on which we are looking at next 3 days of sessions. Now, question is, what is the sphere of influence? You have your private personal, you have got your social networks, you've got the organization networks, you've got your public networks, you've got all kinds of, all of us have got our own areas of influence. And anybody who has a sphere of influence, even if you're a homemaker, you've got the family who's in influence, the leader. And some of us might be students, some of us might be doctors, some of us might be nurses or healthcare professionals, working in government, working in private, working in various areas. Some of us might not be working. All of us have an area of responsibility. That is the area where we are called to excel and be a channel of excellence there. But then all of us have an area of interest. I have an area of interest in music. I have an area of interest in painting. I've got some friends who are interested in music and I talk to them. So each of us may have areas of interest and a small group of people whom you interact with. And all of us have areas of concern. I'm concerned about what is happening in my country. So a group of 10 of us meet regularly, talk about it. So you may have other areas of concern where you've been talking. All these areas are areas of influence what God has given you. So leadership is influence, and anybody who can influence the place in which God has kept you in any area is a leader. Now, what do you lead for? That is a question. Leading for what? Influencing of what? I don't know how many of you have seen this Lion King movie. Lion King movie is worth seeing. Very good movie, series of movies. In Lion King 1, there is this picture of Timon, who is a meerkat. Meerkats live in a tunnel. You know, they dig a tunnel and live under the tunnel. So meerkat under the tunnel, you know, Timon decides to go on a journey. He wants to go beyond his community. He has a vision that he has to do something. So Timon goes on a journey, gets out from his home and starts walking to end of the plains, and suddenly he becomes homesick. He sits under a tree and starts crying, and suddenly he keeps on crying, and this monkey Rafiki lands up there. Rafiki has a conversation with him and talks about the Hakuna Matata, you know, how, you know, be happy, how all those, and then tells him, look beyond what you see. And this Timon starts looking at beyond and says that I can only see a frog. But suddenly his eyes open, he sees that pointed rock with that, you know, that moon behind it. And suddenly his eyes open. Oh, that is what, you know, beyond what I see. So, and he starts that journey. We are leading for a bigger picture, a grand narrative or a big picture. For us Christians, the big picture is the kingdom of God. We'll talk more about it later. But we are leading, whomever, influencing whomever is in the sphere of influence for the big picture of the kingdom, walking towards that. And how do you serve? How do you lead? By serving. Jesus very clearly said, we are here not to be served, but to serve. So our foundations for this 3 days of sessions are, we are called to be people of influence, intentional influence, for the greater purposes of God, by being servants in the places God keeps us, whether it is family, in a college, in your institution, in your place of work. That is our foundation. And people who do that are leaders. If this is so, now how do we lead? If you want to be people who want to be an influence, you need to think, how can you influence? But influence comes out of being a leader and doing leadership task. So I want to look in the first session on how can I or you be a leader, who a person of influence. How can I be a person of influence? How can I be? And the second session we look at what can I do to influence, to be a leader. There are various things we can look at, but for this session we look at six key internal characteristics which any leader should have. The first one is a life of inner security. Now, as you look around in our context, we find many leaders who are severely insecure. How do you identify them? Ask them the question, or when they come up with a decision, object to that decision, or question the authority, or ask them to do a menial task, or see how they behave with their colleagues or their team members. You look at Jesus' life, you read this passage. it was towards the end of his life, just before he was about to face the crucifixion, he washed the disciples' feet. A Jewish rabbi who would never stoop down, who should never wash another person's feet, whose feet should be washed by others, washes the feet of his disciples. And in that group, he had Judas, who would betray him that night, Peter, who would reject him that day, and all the disciples, rest of them, who will run away. Knowing all those, you know, here was Jesus washing the feet. The writer John writes this beautifully, saying that the hour had come for him to leave. He knew the time. Not only that he knew the time, he had come from God and was returning to God. He knew he had come from God and returning to God. What is the writer John trying to communicate? He's trying to communicate that Jesus knew who he was. He was secure in who he was. He knew where he had come from and where he was going and what his time and post, you know, role was. Very important for a leader. If you need to lead, your inner security has to be in place. There are four foundational life questions. Who am I? Question of identity. Am I the position which I have been given? Am I a doctor? Am I a nurse? Is that who am I? No, I am a follower of Christ, a child of God. That identity cannot be changed by anybody. The second question is, where do I come from? I've come from God. Jesus knew they'd come from God. God has brought me into this world. Why am I here? To be part of what God is doing in this world. And where am I going? What's my destiny? Back to God. So these foundational questions and a security in that understanding, that is very important for a leader. There's an interesting book called Mirror Image, written by a psychiatrist who is a psychiatrist for all the big names in Hollywood, including people like Angelina Jolie and the whole group of well-known leaders. He writes about this book, writes in this book about how he has counseled many of these big names. And she says that they all of them are deeply insecure, but externally looking at, they are very secure leaders. And then people look at them and try to imitate them. What do they imitate? The external, what they try to show. But deep inside, they're absolutely insecure. There's a story of the person who, the silent movie, I'm just losing the name, Charlie Chaplin. Charlie Chaplin came out of his hotel room to the lobby and asked for the car to take him to a place. The person in the lobby had forgotten to arrange the car. He fumed, fretted, screamed, and told, "I want 12 limousines." They asked, "Sir, why do you want 12? He said, "11 to go before me and 12th on which I'll go. Because you can't arrange one, I want 12. Now, Charlie Chaplin, if you know, was the person who made everybody laugh through his movies. Now, externally, he was a person who would make everybody laugh, but internally, he was a deeply insecure person. The question is, where are we in our inner security? The second inner perspective is a clarity of the framework of leadership. How do you see leaders? You might see that you might think you are a director or a position. Okay, I want to direct people. Important, that is a role God might give you. You might say you want to influence people for the kingdom or whatever change they want to make. Or you might say that I'm a problem solver. I want to solve the problem. Somebody else might say I'm a driver, maybe driving from the front as a driver, or a shepherd who's driving from the back, slowly encouraging. Or somebody else might turn, I'm a planner. I want to plan and help others to plan. Good. Somebody might say I'm a conductor. I conduct the team along with me, like an orchestra conductor. Somebody else might say, I'm a leader because I'm a trainer. I want to train and build people. Somebody else might say, I'm a manager. I want to manage things and people and the project. Somebody else might say, I want to, you know, give ideas and delegate it to others. Or somebody might say, I come up with new ideas. But whatever might be the framework, these are all important roles of a leader. But all this is founded in the one understanding that you do this by being a servant. Jesus did not talk about servant leadership. Jesus talked about being a servant. Our foundational understanding that I am influencing people by serving them. So servanthood is the foundation. That understanding is very important. That's what Jesus role modeled. When he said, you know, Philippians, Paul wrote, you know, let this mind be in Christ Jesus, who was in the form of God, gave up everything, made himself like a servant, you know, made himself with no reputation. So that is the second perspective you need to, internal understanding you need to hold on. First is your security. Second, an understanding that you and I are called to be servants. The third is those who want to be people of influence has to have a personal life framework and a vision, a personal life vision for a life of influence. Each of us, if we want to be a person of people of influence, you and I have to have a personal life vision. Look at Jesus' life. The first week of his ministry, he walks into this temple, opens this Torah, and reads this out. He says, God has appointed me, his spirit has anointed me, and I am here. To do what? Four things. Good news, freedom, sight, oppress free, and to proclaim. Five things. It was very clear. This is his life narrative, his mission. Now, this is not a, you know, suddenly out of the blue, he took it out. This is from chapter 61 of Isaiah, which is a series of prophecies for the new heaven and new earth. If you look at chapter 65, it ends with this big picture of the kingdom of God, new heaven and new earth. So intentionally, Jesus was taking it up and saying, here am I, do these four or five things so that through that, the big picture of the kingdom can be fulfilled. So there is a big picture with which he was talking about. From that big picture, he is drawing out his life purpose vision statement. And a few months down the line, John sends his disciples to ask him, I'm a bit confused. Are you the same person whom I talked about? I thought you would do something else. John is confused. And Jesus replies saying that, look at what I'm doing. You know, my life will speak for itself. I said, this is what I'll do. Look at my life. This is what I'm doing. You can decide for yourself. This is what you and I should have. Wherever God has placed us, a personal vision statement. You might be in a medical college. You might say, God has kept me at this point of time as a student in my college to excel in my studies, not to be the first, but to excel in my studies within the ability God has given me and be an influence for the kingdom in my class. That is your personal vision statement. Somebody else might say, I am kept at home to be a good homemaker and influence my family for the kingdom. That is your personal vision statement. 5 years down the line it might change, but that statement is important because that gives you the foundation on which you build your external engagement as a leader. A good framework I have found is from Mark 3. When Jesus called his disciples, he told the disciples, I have called you to be with me, to be with him. And in that being, become like him and to be sent out. At the end of the chapter, he says, I have called you to be part of a new family. Now, if you use this framework for your own life, you might come up with a personal framework for yourself. You might say, I am being called by Jesus to become like him and sent out into this medical college to be a channel of influence for the kingdom by being part of a community of believers, your fellowship there. That might be your personal vision statement, but create that. That will be the foundation for your life. That will become, your life will become a called life with a clear personal vision and clarity. The fourth internal characteristic is a leader or a person of influence has to be a person who has personal disciplines of life. Life has to be a disciplined life. What are the disciplines we want to look at? I want to look at three disciplines. One, spiritual discipline. A spiritual discipline of constant engagement with God and growing with God. Paul in his book, in his various writings, gives these three pictures. The picture of an athlete who runs a marathon. They are not on a 100 meter race. We are on a marathon, a long drawn out marathon of influence. What does a marathon runner do? He practices over years to keep running that. So there is a discipline of practicing on a regular basis that relationship with God. Then he gives the picture of the soldier who counts the cost when he goes to war. So we are called in a war, to a war fest. You have to count the cost. And then they give picture of a farmer who sows the seed and waits for God to give the results. So these pictures are given for us to help in our spiritual walk. In one sense, a leader who through these disciplines become like a clay in the potter's hand, being molded into what God wants you to be. So that is the first discipline I want to look at, spiritual discipline. The second, in the role of leadership, you might get caught with so many things to do, so many distractions. This writer beautifully states this. Spiritual leadership is the capacity to see bush burning in the middle of our lives and enough sense and time to take out our shoes and pay attention. In the midst of all the distractions, the discipline is to craft times of noticing in which we allow God to show us things that we might otherwise miss. That discipline to setting aside time in the middle of the chaos in our souls and settle is very important if you have to personal influence. The second discipline, this will lead to a changed life. The second discipline, a discipline of intellect. In the Bible, it talks about David, who was a person of integrity, which means he had a relationship with God. He was a shepherd. He saw leadership as shepherding people. But he also was skillful in the way he did. He had skillful hands, he led them. There is an element of being a skilled person, knowing in your knowledge. A leader is not only a person of integrity, but he also has a skillful hand. Arul talked about the men of Issachar. They knew what to do. How did they know? They knew the history of their community. They knew what God had promised them. That's why they knew, which means you need to be a people of influence, people of knowledge. How do we know? One of the core disciplines of a leader has to be reading. You have to read. You have to read widely. It is said that a good leader reads about 30 books or 30 to 60 books a month. That's too much to ask. Maybe at least 2 to 3 books of various things to read. The other thing is think. A leader, if he thinks that he or she has to be a person of influence, may have many things in his mind or her mind. You have to reflectively think. Use your mind to think, reflect, and come to a few thoughts and a few strategies for a larger influence. You might say, I haven't been placed in this college. So many people I want to influence. I want to do a Bible study. I want to do this. I want to do that. You'll sit and think through what is the one thing which can make a difference. And what are the small group whom I can influence? So you think, reflect. A leader reads, thinks, and reflects. But also thinks rightly about himself. Paul writes, don't think more highly than what you are. Okay, right? Think through the sober judgment. God has given faith and skills to each one of us differently. Use that. Thus, that kind of a life will become a life of competence. The third discipline is a discipline of emotion. Emotional quotient is very important. We need to constantly grow in our emotions, emotional disciplines, where we are people of joy, passion, enthusiasm, and not people who are insecure, jealous, hating or discouraging others, anger, blaming. Insecure leaders end up becoming angry, hating people, worrying too much, doubting. But we have to have the discipline of growing in our emotional quotient. A writer says that spiritual quotient is equal to emotion quotient plus intelligence quotient. I don't agree to this equation, but important is that a leader should have both emotional, intelligent, and spiritual disciplines on which he or she is constantly engaging with. That kind of person will become a person, life, have a life of compassion. The fifth internal discipline is to lead in powerlessness and brokenness. You know, the world will tell you, lead by your strength. When God calls you into positions of influence, most of the time, he puts you in positions where you think you don't have the ability. If you ask me, most of the roles I have played are what I felt I have no strength at all. That's what Paul says, that we have been given this treasure in jars of clay. Because when you know that you can't do it, you depend on God. You will be hard pressed, you will have difficulties, you may not know what to do, but you know you have God within you. You have a communion with God who will enable you. There's this beautiful picture in the Jewish culture, culture. They have this lamps made out of broken jars. They put the pieces together with space in between, and then they'll put the candle inside. This is the picture probably Paul had when he wrote it. Jars of clay with treasure inside, broken jars of clay. But in that kind of an understanding that you don't have the strength, what happens? You commune with God and you depend on each other. You have a dependence on God and interdependence on each other. So a leader does not lead from his strength alone, but leads from an understanding that God is the one who gives the enabling, and there are people around whom, him or her, who can be of support. The last internal characteristic I want to leave with you is a concept of resilience. A leader, a person of influence, will recognize that we are there for a long run. We are not there to finish 2 years and run off. No, we are there for a long run. We are called to be a channel of influence throughout our life. Maybe in one place for 5 years, next place for another 10 years, one place for 2 years, that's a different matter. But we are to be people of influence throughout our life. Like Paul writes about, you know, we have many people who have gone ahead of us. Like them, we will go long, you know, run with perseverance, with resilience, the race marked for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, because it's he who called us to be people of influence. Because he did the same thing. He faced much more difficulty than we are. So how can you give us? So a leader is not a quitter. A person of influence is never a quitter. He's a person of resilience. Daniel was an excellent example. 4 emperors, 3 empires, 70 years in the same place. Challenged with various external contexts, reacting many times with courage, strategically and transformative. Going the long way. Why? Because he had spiritual, emotional, and intellectual disciplines. He would read the word, understand the times. That is what Daniel was. A life of commitment to finishing well. So we looked at 6 characteristics, internal characteristics of a leader. You need to be a person who is secure in yourself. You have to have a clear clarity of your identity. If you don't have that, when people ask questions or ask you who you are, or you know, question your decisions, you'll suddenly become angry, bitter. But if you know your identity is in Christ, no opposition will affect your response. You'll respond with grace. So first we looked at inner security. Second, we looked at that our understanding should be that we are called to be servants. Through that being servant, be a channel of influence, maybe directing, teaching various ways. Third is that you and I need to have a personal life vision. Take time to sit down and look at what your personal life vision is for at this point of time where God has placed you. And fourth was, you and I need to develop our life as a disciplined life, spiritual disciplines of, you know, growing in the knowledge of God, intellectual disciplines of reading and reflecting and thinking. Emotional disciplines of compassion, thus becoming people of character, competence, and compassion. But recognizing that when God puts you in a position or a place to influence others, many times you cannot lead from your strength. It is His enabling which helps you to lead. You need that communion with God. But you also need the dependence on others, the community around for you to lead others. And then the sixth characteristic is they are people of perseverance and resilience who are committed to finishing well. May God enable us to be such people. You grow in your emotional quotient, or how do you control your emotions? Now, a good book to read is Emotional EQ, you know, by Daniel Goleman. He talks about how EQ is very important in leadership. How do you grow in this? Now, our emotions are closely linked to what we know, that is our intellect, and our relationship with God. There are aspects of our emotions which has to be controlled by our knowledge and strength from God. So there is this relationship with our intellectual understanding of the facts of a situation or a context, at the same time the enabling of God. These two play a lot into our emotional stability. There are practices you can do, tools you can use to control your emotions, but you know, positive psychology will give you all kinds of things. But for a Christian, it's about God enabling us to submit our anger, our emotions to God, and allowing God to help us to be a person of compassion and care. At the same time, your thinking, your reflective and thinking life will help you to look at a situation and understand it through the perspectives of God and the reality of the situation. Many times emotions are based on emotional liabilities because we have not really understood the things the way it should be understood. Three aspects. One, you should be very well versed in your area of influence, area of responsibility. You cannot compromise, a leader cannot compromise on the knowledge of his area of responsibility or given to him. So that is one thing is very important. Second is, a leader should read much beyond the area of his responsibility. If I am in healthcare, I am a physician, I should know more than internal medicine. I should know how internal medicine fits into the larger picture of health of a nation. I should read more on the health of the nation, the big picture of how my area of speciality or area of responsibility fits into the bigger picture of the nation, the context, and the place where God has kept us. The third is, if you are to be a leader, you need to read more than your area of theme itself. You need to go more into the area of other areas which influence healthcare. You might want to talk about how development is influencing healthcare, how other things are involving healthcare, how global things are influencing our country. So your reading has to be much broader. Foundational is to take all this and look at from a biblical perspective, which means your understanding of the Bible or using the Bible to understand the context is very important. So there is the element of reading the world and reading the word, understanding the world and what is emerging around through the word. So definitely yes. So Bible is not enough. Bible definitely gives you a framework. Use the Bible to understand the world. But unless you understand the world, you can't understand the context. We are talking about, you know, understanding the context in which we are living. So a leader has to read much broader than the area of his specialty and more than the back. How can you be a servant? That is a question. Can you be servant and make people work? Whatever situation it may be, Remember, you are there to serve people. Now, serving means what? Serving means caring for them, talking to them, influencing them, sometimes disciplining them. Discipline is not against serving. You know, discipline, correction, guiding is all part of serving. So sometimes our picture of serving is, you know, jadu pocha karta hai. So somebody who does our menial work, that is not serving. Serving is helping a person to be fulfill the full potential to which God has made him or her to be. So how do you put, you know, that into your life and be a person of influence?